Everybody, we're back with the handsome, the amazing Mad Dog Magwitch. He's in his very high-tech laboratory right now. If you can tell in the background, he's checking out certain codes. He's making sure things are on the up and up. He might be working for WWE behind the scenes. Magwitch, was that red light that we saw the other night? Was that because you're working for WWE now? What's the red light that we saw during the match between Alexa Bliss and Bayley?
So I think, Teal, you may want to brace yourself.
Yeah.
I think Bray Wyatt the Fiend is coming back.
Oh yeah.
And for the first time ever tonight, he will compete in a match on Friday Night SmackDown.
WWE Universe, this is what nightmares are made of being so malevolent it would make Clive Barker himself weep.
So if anyone didn't see Raw, there was a couple of clues he was coming back. One, there was a QR code, and I think it was in a backstage segment, and if you actually followed the QR code, because apparently we're back in like 2019 again. Remember when QR codes were
Do you want my honest answer today? So we were going to shoot this segment. I have to tell you this. And Mrs. Teal reads the thing and she goes, oh yeah, he also said he wants to talk about the QR code. And I'd be lying if I didn't just tell everybody. This is how old Teal Shark is. I went, what's a QR code? And because I didn't even use them in 2019. So I learned today, you know, it's probably not great for my intelligence quotient, but I learned today exactly what a QR code is. It's just one of those annoying things that pops up on your screen and you take a picture with your phone. And then where did it send you for this particular QR code? What did you see?
So this one, it was a video and it was a little white rabbit on a screen. It was playing Hangman. Mm-hmm. And it was the question was who killed the world? Mm-hmm. Try to remember back to Raw. Who killed the world? And then it spells out you did.
Yeah.
And then it takes you down like an actual virtual rabbit hole, and it says something like come with me. And then it's got like a digital clock, and it's 9:23. Mm-hmm. And I know you Americans love doing your dates backward. You like to put the month before the day.
You
don't do that over here. The rabbit's jumping back forward.
Yeah.
And it's hinting that would be this Friday on SmackDown.
Yeah, well, I have to address something you did say there that has nothing to do with wrestling. Americans need to get on the metric system. That's true. But if they would have put the month or the day before the month, it would say 23/9. There's no 23rd month. So I'm siding with myself on the side of this. I'm glad we did it the American way so we know that on Friday. But here's my follow-up question just that I thought of. I thought it was going to be like a big pay-per-view. I don't see him coming back just for a SmackDown.
I mean, who knows? Like, we know nothing. We're just guessing. We're not insiders. We don't know anything. But it seems like he's coming back. I mean, there's been plenty of clues over the past couple of months. I don't know if you've seen like his kind of cryptic videos that he was doing on like YouTube a while back, and it was like Wyndham 6 and all these things.
Yeah, and he actually put up a thing that I don't know if anybody's connected it. I'm sure I'm not the only one. But Edge is wearing a shirt recently, his new shirt that Edge has that's kind of like it looks like the pits of hell. It literally just looks like it's like a red and white almost sketch or black, red and white, whatever. Wyatt Six on Twitter, he's put up a couple different quotes, but one of the ones he put up probably like 3 times ago when he was talking about like you can only wrestle this, that, and the other, it had the same kind of artwork on it. And I don't know if that's a huge stretch. It probably is. But it was close enough to where I don't know if like they moved Edge from Judgment Day because he's better than Judgment Day, but I would be kind of I don't know, let's just say hypothetically Edge and Bray Wyatt, do they have any beef that would keep them from working together?
I don't think so. I don't think they've ever... I can't think if they've ever actually interacted.
Like cross paths?
Yeah, I don't know, because I think was Bray gone before Edge came back?
Yeah.
I think he might have been. I don't know.
So that's what I'm saying is, if you think about two powerhouses, like, as far as, I don't think anything's bigger than The Fiend, but a lot of people really, really like Edge, especially since he left Judgment Day, and he's kind of going back to the rated R superstar.
Yeah, and then obviously Edge was doing those kind of visionettes a while back when he was hinting he was going, like, to Brood Edge and then Judgment like rated R Edge, and people were thinking that might have been Bray, but obviously it was obvious it was Edge after like the first one, I think.
Yeah.
So yeah, it just kind of came out of nowhere, but you know what?
I'm excited.
Yeah. If it brings them back, that's great.
Yeah.
The only other thing could be is we could all be being duped, and it could be Adam Rose.
Yeah.
That obscure wrestler that was the early 2010s, and he had the big white bunny, but no, I think it's got to be Bray.
Okay, well then, if it's Bray, connect the big white bunny for me, other than it just being creepy and kind of arch. Are they purposely trying to lead some hardcore fans to think it's Adam Rose, or?
No, because mind when he did the funhouse?
Yeah.
White's funhouse, he had that rabbit puppet, mind, and he had the pig that was like... covered in chocolate on its face, and
he had a couple different characters, right?
And he had Vince as the devil. Mm-hmm.
Got that right.
So I think you can safely say it's a thing for Bray Wyatt, because otherwise none of it makes any sense if it's not.
Yeah, and I'm hopeful that the 923 means everything it does, because I have to play devil's advocate, pun intended, I guess, and say, what else could 923 mean, especially with as a digital clock? I saw it too, and like, I don't know if there's something to the fact that they're going back and forth between red and blue. Is that what the colors were? Because is it like I would interpret that as going back and forth between good and evil or day and night, but I think it was just kind of a graphic to bring attention to the numbers themselves.
Or it could have just been going back and forward for Raw and SmackDown. Do you know what I mean?
Oh yeah, that makes way more sense. The blue and the red on everything, Raw, everything, SmackDown. Basically, putting everybody on alert. How to interpret it? Right on. What are your thoughts on Monday Night Raw overall last night?
Wasn't a bad show. There was a lot of kind of good matches, but my grievance is, like, why do we always have to have a match end with
an interruption?
An interruption or a distraction or a DQ. I can't remember now off the top of my head, but I think pretty much every single match ended that way. There might have been one that had a clean finish, but I mean, there's nothing wrong with having clean finishes in wrestling, as long as it's like the story in the ring's told well. But yeah. I don't know, WWE just seem intent on this 50-50 booking, so that like I don't know, for example, like Judgment Day win this week, but like Mysterio and Riddle will win next week, sort of thing. Do you know what I mean? They all seem to go back and forth on this, and then it doesn't really mean anything.
So let's play devil's advocate and ask kind of a fair question, but maybe an uncomfortable. Everybody's excited that Vince McMahon's gone. I am too. Everybody is. I'm excited that Triple H is at the helm. But is this a possible product of Triple H trying to, in a very good way, get more people fairly involved and not kind of shit on people's character? Because as much as we hated when Vince did that, if Vince wanted to have somebody lose for 7 weeks in a row to make sense out of them losing, he didn't have to do a DQ or things like that. He's an asshole, basically, Vince McMahon. Yeah. You know.
But I also heard on a podcast, I can't remember whose podcast it was, but apparently there was times where Vince would do the same match like 3 weeks in a row because he'd forgotten he'd already done that match, and then he'd forget
guys, so we're playing the odds to win. He's part asshole, part senile, and we're just glad he's gone altogether. Then let me reframe my question. Are there some bad things about Triple H being in charge, even if it is, like, one thing I've noticed, I don't think there's really is, but one thing I like, to start with this, and then I'll let you answer that question, is it seems like he's stringing the start of shows into the first match. There's a lot less, like, stale, down, talking, going to look at the crowd, ads. It's like they basically come out, talk, but if they talk, whoever's out there immediately has a match following it with somebody. They don't go in the back and just be like, well, that was a nice Cody Rhodes 20 minutes, you know?
Like, I think the difference with WWE and like maybe like AEW or even like lesser kind of smaller promotions like Impact, WWE, especially on Raw, seem intent on they've got to have a promo to start the show.
Mm-hmm.
It's very rare that they kick things off with just a match.
Yeah.
And sometimes those promos are a bit too long. Like, it can be like a 15-minute promo. Mm-hmm. Some weeks, it felt like that for quite a long time, and it was just, I don't know, just felt no need. Like, yeah. I felt like the only time you really needed a promo kicking off the show was if something big happened, like the week before or on the SmackDown before, and like somebody's pissed and they've come out to address something. Like,
yeah,
like I think like back in the days, the Attitude Era, like if Triple H had like screwed over The Rock or Austin, like,
yep, then they'd have to start with a promo.
The show before, they'd come out and they'd be pissed off or whatever, and start with a promo and call them out. But I think they need to mix it up a little. I don't think they need to have like these promos every single show starting things off.
Yeah, I think it really repels casual fans in the sense that, like, my wife, she's been watching a lot of wrestling with me since I've been back into it. We both like it for different reasons. She loves the storyline. We both appreciate good matches, everything like that. But when the first 15 minutes, when you turn it on, you're kind of like, oh yeah, we're turning into like, how's it going to start? You're like, you're kind of fired up and you get an adrenaline dump. And it's this weird, like, psychological thing for me. If it goes a certain amount of time, no matter how good, even if like Kevin Owens is killing it on the promo, it's like after a certain amount of time, and I don't really know what that window time is, you just kind of get this adrenaline dump, and you're like, all right, what's the next thing that's coming up? No matter how good it is, it's like they need to start with fireworks is what I'm kind of getting at.
I mean, you know the formula. You know there's going to be some guy in the ring, either a heel or a face. They're going to be cutting a promo. Then somebody's going to come out and interrupt them, and then it'll be they'll either get into a fight there and then, or it'll be, right, just announced the main event is going to be these two fighting later on tonight. And then you're like, wait, so you started, you booked a whole wrestling show and you didn't have your main event?
Yeah, it's stupid. It's an awkward situation. I think what it needs to lead to, and I think they need more creative writers. Not everybody has to do crazy shit like Vince Russo. No, let's not go down that path. But since we're also involved in gaming, how much would you play a video game, just a thought that I came off the top of my head, that's basically PC-based or console-based, doesn't matter, but it's realistically you just booking matches, and but it has the open creativity to where you actually get to type in and write in the script. So you could be like, instead of guy walks down ramp, you could literally be like, comes through the crowd with a chair, write stuff that one way or another hasn't been done, and it simulates it for you to watch as a wrestling match.
Yeah, you could have, like, because obviously there's, you've got a Football Manager, which is, like, a big, like, simulation game for, like,
super
like
fun. All
the football games around the world and stuff, and each year they bring out an extra thing to make it a bit more realistic. So, yeah, it would take a lot of coding, I guess, but, yeah.
It'd be pretty difficult, but it'd be something that I think would be pretty fun. If you got to play Matchmaker for a day, and you don't have to make any match anybody's heard of, or you can just use whatever match, what two people are you going to make a match for? Any people today. In AEW, you can put AEW, WWE, you can put anybody you want together. What's your match that you're making and style of match?
I think I would like to see, and it's probably going to happen in the next like couple of years, but I would like to see like MJF go over to WWE.
Yeah.
And I know he's quite similar to Miz in some ways, but
mm-hmm.
I think if you had MJF come out and like cut a promo on like one of WWE's big talent, I don't know, maybe even like Roman Reigns, that could be quite interesting because you could have like the two different styles, but obviously MJF's a heel as well, so
yeah.
But
they do it different ways.
Yeah. And I just think it'd be, I think it'd just be interesting to see. Obviously, I know WWE's went to, is it PG-13 now or whatever it is?
Oh, it's TV-14, I think. Something TV-14. Like that. Yeah, right? Yeah. One. Yeah.
So, but I guess he would have to tone it down, like his promos, because obviously the stuff he says in AEW, he probably wouldn't get away with as much in WWE, but...
Yeah.
Because I remember he cut one, like, a few weeks or a few months back, before he went off air, and it was Brian Pillman's son he was having a go at, and he was like calling his mum like a whore and his sister a whore and all this stuff.
It was like, that's, we're gonna have to edit that whole thing out. WWE, they're like, well, that's cool, but the people in the front row saw it, but it didn't make it to TV. We blocked all that. Yeah, he'd have to tone it down. I think MJF would do good in the WWE, but it, like you said, it might be a situation on a total different premise is why like New Jack wouldn't do good in WWE or something. You know, it's like, He's too wild. The thing that we love about him is that he's not really the cookie cutter style wrestler.
So. Yeah, I mean, there's plenty of matches like see between people just because of like how good they are like in the ring, especially like some of the people that are like from like New Japan and stuff like that. But
oh yeah,
I don't know. It just depends on if you get the storyline right. Like I feel like the problem with AEW a lot of time is as well they just go, oh, we can get these people from Japan and we'll just have them in a match, but it's like, well, what was the point? Do you know what I mean? It's
like,
just
what like, is the storyline? Yeah.
Just for like, the sake of having them as a match.
Yeah, nobody besmirched anybody. Nobody crossed anybody over. I'm with you. I like a good storyline. And that leads me to the question of the day. Intergraphic. Hold on. Question of the day. I'm sure it'll get edited in there. It'll look really cool. We'll make sure we do that. What the fuck is going on with Logan Paul versus Roman Reigns?
It's an easy match to put on for that Blood, Oil, Money show, whatever you want to call it, the one that I don't right. watch, the yep. Crown Jewel. It's a glorified house show. Do you know what I mean? It's just like, it's a house show that they film and they put on in Saudi Arabia, and then, although I don't know how they're going to work, this is a bit of a tangent. Is it Mansoor?
Yeah.
Which was the maximum male model guy?
No. As Mansoor, but no. He has now found a love for fashion as well. You can now call him Mansoor.
Mansoor.
Absolutely another model. Mansoor. With the fanny pack across the chest. Looking like Michael Hayes from the 50s all the way through now.
Mansoor.
His name is Mansoor now, Abel, okay? But go ahead.
Mansoor. Like, obviously, they always just had him just appear and win because he's like from there. So it was like he was always just winning.
The old
every
WWE
time, but,
racist card every time. Yeah.
But I don't know how his maximum male model gimmick would go down well.
He's not winning any matches as that. They're literally like I feel like the maximum male models they're titillating juices, but they're not gonna win matches. I feel like that's their job. Is to lose.
Yeah, but I just mean I don't think that male model gimmick works in Saudi. So it might be interesting if they revert him back to what he was before, just for the pay-per-view, because he's going to appear on it, because that's like one of the whole things. But anyway, in regards to Roman and Logan Paul, is it Logan or Jake? I can never remember.
It doesn't matter. It really doesn't.
Yeah, whatever.
It's Logan. It was
an easy feud. He's like a famous YouTube guy, so like probably over there they'll lap it up. But
it's just an easy match that doesn't hurt anybody.
Yeah, exactly, and it didn't require much booking. It means Roman gets to defend his title and still hold on it, and it's another person on the list.
Yeah.
It's probably another way for WWE to try and get Logan Paul over.
And casual viewers, they'll try to get casual viewers that are his.
Well, because it's like, oh, there's that guy who did the boxing, and he's a YouTuber, and he's done all this stuff, and he's got a podcast and all that. Yeah, it's an easy thing.
So that's I'll talk about. Go ahead. Go ahead, I'm sorry.
Yeah, it's just an easy thing to try and get him over, and then it doesn't, when he loses, it doesn't really harm anyone, and they don't need a storyline for it. And yeah. then after that, they can just obviously build towards Survivor Series, which is something that I'm looking forward to this year. So
yeah, my thing, the uncomfortable kind of like elephant in the room is basically like it's a show that they're having in Saudi Arabia. I know you talked about it. It's Blood Money Oil. Saudi Arabia killed Jamal Khashoggi, who is from America. There's a lot of things that they've done. I'll talk about it because, you know, it needs to be talked about. But it's a duality in the sense that if the show's going to be kind of a watered-down bullshit fucking gimmick anyway, which is how I see exactly what they're doing with Logan and Roman Reigns, why didn't WWE just kind of make a stand and say we're not going to Saudi Arabia? And I know there's a lot of people that say, like, you can't do that and you can't start doing political and everything, but it just doesn't feel political when it feels like people are, like, killing people. They're throwing golf tournaments in America to basically, like, you know, cozy up to people. So I don't like it. I'll be honest, even when we play the game WWE 2K, I went in and I made it to where it won't, like, put us in a Saudi Arabia arena, because I feel like it's annoying. But the main thing I'm saying is, as a fan of wrestling, not just a person that's on a tangent about Saudi Arabia, but if you have to water down the show for a shitload of casual fans that are just going to throw money at it that you're bringing anyway, then make a stand. I know it'll probably cost them too much money to do it, right? So I get it. It's a money business. But, man, it would say a lot to a lot of people if they're like, hey, we're just not doing Crown Jewel anymore. It's kind of a gimmick anyway. I would be like, oh, shit, I'm getting a WWE sweater tomorrow. But
yeah, I don't know how long their deal is that they signed. So maybe maybe it's like a contract that they signed and it's for so many years. But maybe,
yeah,
maybe they'll just see the deal out and then not do it again. But
yeah, and
I've never really watched it. I've seen like clips from the internet and stuff just because I'm just thinking I'm not tuning into that. But
yeah,
nothing will beat obviously Shawn Michaels when he was bald and. Kane's mask falling off, and Triple H, Michaels, Kane, and Undertaker just all botching everything during that match.
Are you saying that the WWE doesn't send its best talent to Saudi Arabia? Is that what you're guys? This just in? No, it's just for money. Yeah. No, that's right. It's just for money when they go for Crown Jewel. It's a bunch of bullshit. Well,
I don't know if I'm right because I haven't. Really watch them, but I don't think Sami Zayn ever participates in it anyway, and I don't think Daniel Bryan did either. I think Daniel Bryan took a stand against it when he was there.
Good.
I think it was a couple of guys that kind of refused to go. Yeah. But yeah, it's not something I'll be tuning in.
Lots of reasons not to. Watered down, supports a bad cause, and, you know, there'll be wrestling on the next week. We'll see the highlights of it. I'm with you, bro. Yeah, fuck Crown Jewel. I'll say it. do you have any threats or any promises of what's going to happen if The Fiend doesn't show up on 9/23? And I bend kind of this and I edit it and tell everybody that Abel guaranteed us that we could get our Fiend masks and everything ready for 9/23. Do you want to start backpedaling? Because you did. You said I totally guaranteed. He didn't say that, but you said. Go.
I mean, what do I know anyway? I thought he wouldn't return till maybe the Rumble or Mania. So.
What do you know? You're able the Mad Dog Magwitch, bro. You're the owner operator of GEW. You're my man in the room when it comes to everything wrestling. Don't you talk about yourself like that? Don't you talk like that?
I mean, it's just all rumor and innuendo, really. But yeah, I think it's got to be Bray that comes back, because otherwise, none of it really makes any sense.
Yeah, I agree with that, and I honestly mainly because I don't know who the other guy you're talking about with the rabbit thing, but I really hope it's not that guy, because it makes just enough sense for them to kind of do that and be like, well, we'll bring Bray back eventually, but that was to kind of just fuck with everybody, like. That's not cool, Triple H. Like, really cool, but also, that wouldn't be very cool.
The funniest thing would be if they didn't bring either of them back, and they just brought the guy that was in the bunny suit back.
Oh, my God. That would be tomato time. That's where whoever's there better throw some goddamn tomatoes. Could you imagine?
If I remember correctly, they even made, like, an action figure like a wrestling action figure of that bunny.
Oh my god!
Bunny suit, and it—I think the person wrestled like two matches in that suit.
Oh my god! That thing probably smelled horrendous by the time it was over. Yeah, that's terrible. Well, Mad Dog, we're gonna do this as often as possible, but you know what time it is? It's time to play that game. What you know about that? Able Mad Dog Magwitch, your first hockey term is back check. What is a back check?
Back check. Is it like, because in football you've got a thing like called a pass back, and if you do that, like you pass the ball back to the goalkeeper, and if he picks it up with his hands, then it's an indirect free kick to the other team.
That's a tap back. Yeah. I believe, and that's, or something of the sort. That's a great guess. No, in hockey, a back check is where you agree that right before each game, you'll check each one of your teammates' backs to make sure they don't have any back acne. No, that's not true. That's not true. It's what you do is if you're the guy chasing down the guy that's running away with the puck, what you back check means you're trying to catch up from behind and affect the play by stick lifting him or hitting him. You're checking from behind.
So like a professional foul then?
Yeah, absolutely. You're making sure to catch up to him one way or the other, whether it hurts him or not, you know? You're back checking like crazy. What is a celly? That's a lob.
A celly?
A celly. You can use your one, use it in a sentence if you'd like.
Use it in a sentence.
All right. So I'll use it in a sentence, but I'm going to make it a run-on sentence. All right, so Abel Mad Dog Magwitch was playing some soccer. He got a pass from another fella. He passed it back to that fella. He went down. He spun around a guy. He nutmegged a guy. He tossed it up, bicycle kicked it, and then he sellied hard.
Oh, celebrate.
Yeah. Well, that's why it was so easy, so I want to make it really long and drawn out and arduous and obnoxious. Well, you know me. We've met. So, yeah, sellie just means celebrate. Magwitch, you already told me what hooking was, and that has nothing to do with hockey. Oh, Mad Dog Magwitch, this is, we're going to have to be adults here, but Magwitch, will you tell me what the, what's a five hole?
Excuse me?
Yeah, I didn't hear it if you farted, but what's a five, what's the term five hole in hockey? And I'll give you a tip. You don't have to pass the first four holes to get there. That would be fifth hole. What's five hole in hockey?
I have absolutely no idea.
You have to guess. It's you have to.
I don't know. Is it if you score five goals?
That's a good guess. But when the goalie stands in his stance, the one hole is like, I believe it's like next to him. The two is like up over his shoulder. The five hole is right between his legs. So if you shoot right between a goalie's legs, you five hold him.
Ah, right. So it's where to aim when you're taking a shot.
It sounds way more exciting than it really is. You already know 10 ply. All right. I'm going to ask you one more question. What does it mean if somebody is Swiss cheese in hockey?
Is it the goalie's rubbish? He's full of holes?
Fuck yeah. Abel Mad Dog Magwitch, you're 100% right. So you start calling any of those goaltenders, those goalies that are on the pitch, if they can't save shit, you start telling everybody, this guy's over here selling, but I don't know why he's selling, because he's Swiss cheese. You know what I mean? He's goddamn 10-ply.
He's goddamn 10-ply, yeah.
Goddamn 10-ply. You know who's not 10-ply? Abel Mad Dog Magwitch. Bad motherfucker. Abel, thank you for doing this with me. What's Abel got coming up this week?
I don't know if I'm going to have a stream this week. I've got quite a lot of stuff going on, but if I do, I'll put it on Twitter and Discord and stuff if I stream. But when I am back, which might be next week with GEW, I'm having a there's going to be like a championship tournament to crown number one contender for the GEW championship. So,
oh, yeah, baby.
So that'll be happening, but I don't think it'll be this week because I've got a lot of stuff going on, including going to see a potential wedding venue with Miss Abish.
Yeah. Are you excited to be getting married? You have to show me your excited face. Yeah, congratulations, brother. I'm excited for you.
Thanks, man. Havish will just say that I've not done anything that she's planned at all so far, which is true. Yeah, but no, I'm looking forward to it.
Once you're married, she'll just be like, get out of the way anyway. I don't want to. They, like, before you're married, they're like, you should help. And then, like, I'm trying. And then once you're married, it's like, you know, it gets done a lot quicker if you just, you know, fuck right off. And I go, okay. You know, so start smoking weed if you need, Magwitch. You know, it might help. man, it's been a great interview. Thank you very much. Like I said, we'll do this as often as you want, man. Hit me up anytime.
No worries. Thanks for having me on again, Teal. And I'm glad I didn't lose you all your viewers last week. So
you never will, bro. With a handsome mug like that and the wrestling knowledge you got, we'll see you every week.
Thanks, man.
All right. Love you, buddy. Have a good day.
You too. Bye-bye.